Honoured guests, ladies and gentlemen, it is with great pleasure that I welcome you to this very important event for our ACU community, a respectful conversation on marriage. In particular, I would like to acknowledge the presence of our very generous and distinguished panel members this evening, Bishop Peter Commensoli, the Honourable Christina Keneally, Tim Wilson and Paul Kelly. I would also like to welcome the members of the New South Wales chapter, Sister Monica Kavanagh, the Congregational Leader of the Sisters of St. Joseph, John McGrath, the Project Officer for the NCEC Faith Formation and Religious Education, and my own colleagues, Professor Wayne McKenna, DVC Research, Professor N. Cummins, DVC Students Learning and Teaching, Professor David Hall, Dean of the La Salle Academy, and Professor Jude Butcher, the Director of the Institute for the Advancement of Community Engagement. And of course, a very warm welcome to our many friends, Catholic partners, representatives of the media, ACU staff, and of course, our very special students. My name is Professor Maria Nicholson. I'm the Associate Vice Chancellor for New South Wales and ACT, and I will be your Master of Ceremonies this evening. I would now like to invite Cassandra Gibbs, cultural mentor Yalbalinga, who will lead us in the acknowledgement of country.
Yama Malias, Gurungai Nyale, Dawan Gurungai Wilingala Nanyini, Gugud Gurungai Wingala Nanyini, Wayama Gurungai Wilingala Nanyini, Bayemi Walangaba, Banal Ninanya, Gimblawee Marigali, Ninanyu Gimbla Giru. My name is Cassandra. I'm a Gamilaroi woman from Gadugga in northwest New South Wales. In the language of my old people, those words translate as, hello friends, this is Gurungai country. We acknowledge the Gurungai land, we acknowledge the Gurungai elders, and we acknowledge the Gurungai ancestors. We've asked the ancestors of this country to be with us, to walk with us, to guide us in our sharing of story and in our conversations today. By MEBA and I, thank you all and go with God.
Okay. Thank you, Cassandra. We'll begin this evening in our university prayer. And as we gather our thoughts, we pray, God of all truth and goodness, bless us as we gather here at Australian Catholic University. May we be strengthened in mind and heart to pursue what you inspire with insight and deliberation, that our world may advance in true wisdom and justice for all, through Christ our Lord.
Amen. Amen.
It is now with great pride and pleasure that I welcome our Vice Chancellor, Professor Greg Craven, who will be our moderator for this evening's event.
Well, thank you very much, Maria, and I've been told to do this sitting down, so I will obey. Thank you all very much for coming. In particular, thank you to our panel. As Maria said, this has been entitled A Respectful Conversation on Marriage, and obviously the word that stands out in that title is respectful. And it's an important word because this is a very, very intense topic. It's a topic on which people hold a range of sincere views, some opposite, some nuanced, and it's a debate in which sometimes there can be a potential for more heat than light. So this is an occasion where we've really wanted to bring together people with a range of different views and to have very much an exchange of views. These debates can't effectively be held with two groups of people talking to people who they agree with in hermetically sealed rooms. And this is the exact opposite of that type of thing. The Australian Catholic University, from its very name, we know is a committed part of the Catholic intellectual tradition. It's not part of the church militant, but it is part of the church intellectual. And in that context, we really do want to foster an exchange of views on all sides in an atmosphere of respect. And that's what a Catholic university should do, as Pope John Paul II said, to promote a dialogue between faith and reason. And this obviously is an opportunity in a very particular important context to all Australians to do that. From a purely university dimension, putting aside the Catholic nature of the thing, it's an opportunity to promote freedom of speech and intellectual freedom. Freedom of speech and intellectual freedom is not a freedom for those who agree with us to be free. It's a freedom that is shared by everybody. And with all this in mind, we've managed to assemble, and we're very grateful for having assembled them, a very distinguished panel with a range of views. The Honourable Christina Keneally, the former Premier of New South Wales, Tim Wilson, the Australian Human Rights Commissioner, Bishop Peter Comensoli, the Bishop of Broken Bay, and Paul Kelly, the Editor-at-Large for the Australian newspaper. In terms of format, the way we will handle this evening is that each of our guests will speak for around 8 minutes. I will time them, but would not even think of interrupting anyone so eminent, so I lay a vast moral obligation upon them for self-regulation. After that, there will be questions, and there will be two sets of questions. We've taken some pre-submitted questions that I will put immediately at the end of the presentations to our panellists, and we'll have about 10, 12 minutes to do that. But you all have cards on your seat. So what I would do is I would ask you at the conclusion of the last presentation by the last panellist, if you have a question that you would like, if you could write it down, they will be collected, and there will be some mystical process by which those questions will come up here. We're doing it this way because it's a much quicker way to move through questions, a much more organised way, and we'll try and get through as many of those questions as we possibly can. If I can then move to introduce our first speaker, and I have, of course, improbably distinguished biographies, which I'm sure none of them particularly want me to repeat in enormous depth, but you all know that Christina Keneally was the first woman Premier and Premier of New South Wales, elected to Parliament in 2003, had been the Minister for Disability Services, Ageing, World Youth Day, that she is now Adjunct Professor and Director for Gender Inclusion at the Macquarie Graduate School of Management, and has had another distinguished career as a sports administrator, and is patron of the Stillbirth Foundation Australia. So if I could introduce her.
Thank you very much, Professor Craven. And I will ask you to interrupt me. I'm quite used to being timed and bells ringing when I've gone over the limit, so please feel free. Thank you all for coming tonight. Thank you to my fellow panelists as well. The question of same-sex marriage, it goes to our core beliefs about how families form, how children are raised. It requires us to consider views, you know, that might be in conflict or congruence with our values and beliefs. And for many of us, it raises issues of faith. And I respect that each one of us will bring our own personal perspectives, beliefs, and judgment to the issue. In terms of a state, the Parliament, there are very few issues where the state interferes so directly and intimately in the lives of people. Who can marry, who can form families, who can adopt children. And I often grappled with these during my time in Parliament. In forming my position on same-sex marriage, that is, my support for same-sex marriage, I've considered my experiences as a wife and mother, my responsibilities as a legislator, my conscience as a Christian, and as a member of the Catholic faith. And I want to speak to each of these very briefly in my opening remarks, but I also want to make clear at the outset, the position to which I have arrived is this. Not only should Australian law change to allow for same-sex marriage, so too should the teachings of the Catholic Church. Let me also be clear that in my voting record as a parliamentarian, I've always supported exemptions from anti-discrimination legislation for faith-based organizations and would continue to do so should Australia legalize same-sex marriage. Now, as a Christian and a Catholic, I accept that some people may legitimately question how I can support same-sex marriage. How can I hold a position that appears to be in contrast with the teachings of my faith? But I don't see that position as being contrast to Catholic teaching. I see it as being faithful to the Catholic tradition, and particularly its teachings on conscience. Now, We all know conscience is a tricky area when one wants to claim it as a basis for disagreeing with the church's teachings. It often leads to accusations of being a cafeteria Catholic, choosing only the parts of the church teaching that you want to agree with. But the Second Vatican Council did declare that we're bound to follow our conscience faithfully, that no one can be forced to act in a manner contrary to their conscience. But conscience must be properly formed. It's not a feeling. It's a decision to act based on thorough consideration. And a Catholic conscience must give attention to and respect church teachings. But it's also bound to consider science, reason, human experience, scripture, and other theological reflection. Now let's start with scripture. I mean, the New Testament isn't particularly a great deal of help in this area, though perhaps its relative silence is instructive in and of itself. As the American Jim Wallace points out, there are 3,000 references in the Bible to alleviating poverty, but there are very few on homosexuality. And the Australian Christian Lobby's Jim Wallace acknowledges that there's no place where Jesus taught one way or another about same-sex marriage. But Jesus did have a lot to say about self-sacrifice, about laying down one's life for another, and about loving one another as he loved us. Jesus talked a lot about love. He talked about it constantly. I'm not going to repeat all of his comments, but you know them. A new command I give you, love one another. As I have loved you, so you must love one another. For Jesus, this law to love one another governs above all else. And it's not just any love, but it's an unselfish love, a love that seeks to mirror God's love for us, a love that is shown not just to our relatives, not just to our friends, but to all of those around us. We're to love them as much as we love ourselves. And that's the overwhelming message of the Christian Gospels, unselfish, self-sacrificing love. Now, if we are to accept that, my pages have gone in the wrong order. So I want to talk a bit about if we're to accept that that notion of self-sacrificing love. If I look at homosexual couples who are entering into monogamous, self-giving, self-sacrificing relationships to one another, how can I but see a mirror image of God's love for us, of Jesus' call to love one another? Now, Jesus had a lot to say about same-sex marriage, but what does the church teach on homosexuality? The church does have a lot to say about same-sex marriage. Now, the Catholic tradition tells us that all humans are created in the image and likeness of God, and that homosexual orientation in and of itself is a natural thing. It is not sinful or blameworthy. But that homosexual activity, in fact, is. The science affirms the church's view that homosexual orientation is genuine. But I ask, if we are all made in the likeness of God, how can that natural orientation, made in God's likeness, turn sinful when it is given expression through physical acts of love? I don't accept that orientation becomes a sinful act necessarily because an individual acts upon it. And the church itself struggles with maintaining this distinction. The U.S. bishops say in their document, Human Sexuality, which came out in 1990, that this distinction is not always clear and convincing, this distinction between homosexual orientation and homosexual activity. But the church, the bishops say, it's a helpful and important one. I disagree with that completely. How can we accept that God makes people homosexuals but then condemns them as sinners if they enter into mutual, self-giving, self-sacrificing, and yes, sexual monogamous relationships? It seems to me like God's cruel joke. It's okay to be a homosexual, just don't act on it. And if we accept that heterosexual people who are physically unable to have children can express themselves in physical acts, then why aren't people who God created with a homosexual orientation able to do the same? I mean, many of us as Catholics know that the church teaches that sexual activity must always be open to the possibility of conception and procreation. But we also know that in reality, the church doesn't hold this view in all circumstances. There's no prohibition on infertile married couples having sexual relations of people who are beyond the age of being able to conceive, having sexual relations. And this is because the church does recognize that sexual activity, alongside its purposes for procreation, is an example of two people giving to one another in that mutual and loving way. And in fact, in many places in Scripture, that act of such love is analogous to the love that God has for God's people. And then finally, informing my conscience, the church asks me to consider what I know in terms of human experience. And I've known my friends who suffered because of judgment from their families and communities. I've witnessed friends who are more acquainted with loneliness than romantic relationships. Friends who are devout Catholics, some of whom with a call to vocation, grieving because their church has no place for them. And I've realized that no one would choose an orientation that brings such misery. And I can't believe that a loving God would create people in God's own image and likeness and deny them the ability to truly express themselves in relationship with others. I also know as a mother, one of the greatest gifts that I can give to my children is unconditional love and a nurturing and stable home. And I know as a legislator that many children in our society are denied this. So when I see same-sex parents offering that same self-sacrificing love to children through adoption, how can I not be reminded of Jesus' call to love one another? Now finally, and very briefly, I want to talk about being a pro-gay marriage and indeed a feminist Catholic. One of our greatest ecclesiologists of the modern era is Hans Küng, a Swiss Catholic priest who asserts that the church is both sinful and sinless, that it's made up of the people here on earth and of the kingdom of God in heaven. And he takes seriously the claim that we're called to bring about the kingdom of God on earth. And what do I see in that? Well, I see a church that doesn't belong to Rome or the hierarchy exclusively. I see a church that's made up of all its believers. I see a church that's on a mission, striving to perfection, making mistakes and evolving, full of grace and seeking forgiveness. And when people ask me how I can reconcile being a Catholic with being a feminist, or with my views on same-sex marriage, or indeed on a few other issues, I try to describe this vision of church. I try to explain what my faith means to me, how the liturgy and the sacraments and the rituals sustain me, and how I find grace and forgiveness and acceptance within the Catholic Church. Yes, I find things that abhor and disgust me, like the sexual abuse of children, and I condemn them. I also find discrimination in teachings I don't accept and want to change. But none of these takes away from the core tenets of my faith, that Jesus is both human and divine, the Son of God, calling me to love one another, to love my fellow human beings, and in Jesus I'm saved. And when people ask, why not convert? I say, why? Why give up the sacraments, the liturgy, the ritual, and the faith that the church gives to me? If Hans Küng is right, indeed if Vatican II is right, then we are all the church. And the history of our church makes clear that our church can change, that the attitudes, the teachings, and understandings can evolve along with human experience, that the Holy Spirit can move within the church to stir the hearts of believers. And when it comes to issues around same-sex marriage, it is my fervent hope and prayer that the Holy Spirit does move the hearts of our believers. Thank you.
Well, thank you very much. And that was without bells or even sort of leering towards you, just that was great. Our second speaker, Tim Wilson, has been Australia's Human Rights Commissioner since February 2014. He's been particularly focused on advancing traditional human rights and freedoms, including free speech, freedom of association, religious freedom and property rights. And he also acts as the de facto commissioner for sexual orientation, gender identity and intersex issues. Before joining the commission, he was a policy director at the IPA. He's made a number of major publications, including a recently co-edited book, Turning Left or Right, Values in Modern Politics.
Do you have a chapter in that?
Sorry?
Did you have a chapter in that?
I have chapters in so many things. Did I have a chapter in that?
I can't recall.
Okay, look, it would have been a much better book if I had. And it's a great book if it does. So on that note, if I could introduce Tim Wilson.
Well, thank you very much, Vice-Chancellor. And I'd like to really begin by thanking ACU and yourself and Julian and others for bringing this conversation together. I've actually been involved in this debate around marriage for same-sex couples now, and it scares me because in part I'm starting to feel like my age for over a decade. And in fact, if you go back and look at my writings in 2007 and 2008, I've specifically always been interested in the discussion around marriage for same-sex couples and its interrelationship with religious liberty and how much it can have an impact on that. But at the same time, my view has always been strong and consistent. I am not a person of faith. But I believe that same-sex couples should be able to access the civil institution of marriage for the very simple reason that if everybody has the same civil responsibilities, then everybody must also have the same civil rights as well. But I think when we talk about an institution like marriage, we need to recognise that no one has a singular monopoly on it. It is not an institution in which people have a private religious faith and therefore that trumps some other group's understanding or awareness. We need to recognise it has multiple purposes in our society. For many people, it has a religious tradition. For other people, it has a civil or a legal tradition. It also has an incredible amount of cultural power. And I actually think we massively understate that component of cultural power, about what it means in a society to say you're married, what it means to refer to your significant other as a husband or a wife, and how much we, as the rest of community, makes an understanding or a judgment about people's relationships when we use that particular use of phrase. And I've got to say, I've been in the US for the past couple of weeks, and watching the debate and the discussion around what happened after their significant decision in the US Supreme Court, a decision which I agree with the outcome, but I disagree with the process and the reasoning, is not how much that decision affected same-sex couples. I think they looked at their relationships already as forms of marriages or some form of long-term stable commitment equivalent to marriage. What I noticed particularly this time was how much that that decision has reflected and changed how the rest of the community has seen their relationships and seen the enduring power of committed relationships amongst same-sex couples, and talked about why they're strengthened, why they're important, and why they have value, and how much that decision in its own way has liberated the discussion from debating who can get into a marriage and refocused it directly and importantly where it belongs, on the importance of marriage and why as an institution it should be put on a pedestal within our society because of its importance and the values that underpin it. And one of the things I find most frustrating about the discussion debate is a lot of people, these days at least, say that they have no issue with same-sex couples having their relationships recognised by the state. We should just have some sort of civil union or civil partnership or civil registration. We already have all of those different instruments through different arms of state law in particular. We also have, of course, have de facto relationship recognition. But if you believe in the enduring power of marriage, as I do, as it is a very conservative aspiration that it is, then we need to stop creating marriage-like relationships in law. Nothing demeans the institution of marriage more than creating alternatives that you can have without the same degree of cultural and social commitment that comes with marriage. We also need to recognise the reality of where we are in this discussion. I actually agree with people who argue that allowing same-sex couples to marry is a significant change. It is. Because it was only 40 years ago that we weren't judging or making decisions about how to recognise people's relationships based on whether we thought they should be married or not. We judged homosexual relationships based on whether people should be put in jail because of their relationships or not. And that continues to leave a legacy and a scar, those types of laws, on attitudes towards same-sex attracted people today. We went through a period of recognising that people shouldn't be thrown in jail, that there then had to be some validity to their relationships if they are going to be lawful, and we created recognition through de facto relationships and the like. Today, we are now debating whether we should properly respect them equal to all other relationships with the same degree of commitment and bond. And the practical reality is the Australian public has said yes. Now, just because something's popular doesn't mean it's always right. But I challenge anybody to think of an equivalent issue where you have seen such a dramatic attitudinal shift in such a short period of time. In 1990, there was a poll done by the Australian Institute of Family Studies, which showed that 3% of the population strongly agreed that same-sex couples should be able to marry. 11% agreed. We don't have disaggregated data between strongly agreed and just agreed today, but we know that we can equate roughly the 14% figure in 1990 to the most recent polls, which show somewhere around 65 to 75% of people agree that same-sex couples should be able to marry. In an incredibly short period of time. And that didn't happen because people just one day woke up and changed their attitude. It happened because since we decriminalised homosexual acts, people saw the common humanity that existed in those relationships between their friends, their family members, their colleagues, and why those people weren't just people engaged in sexual activity. They were making commitments to each other. They were recognising and respecting those commitments and building their own family units in the way that they could. And I can't understand, and I still struggle with it, why we wouldn't want to give equal protection in law for that significant relationship. If you actually are a conservative, as it were, surely we want people to be in those types of relationships because they're so important. I equally challenge the idea directly that these issues haven't been fully debated, as is often proffered, that it's a relatively new discussion. In one sense, for many people it is. But the reality is the arguments against this issue have all been heard over a very long period of time. For starters, we need to recognise that the opposing case is the default position. It's the existing law. It's been challenged consistently and been found by the public not to hold weight. To continue that discussion into the future won't do anything to increase the chances of it being successful. Now, we can have a public vote on this issue if we want, but the practical reality is the more we talk about this issue, the more people actually tend to agree that same-sex couples have important relationships and they should be protected equally in law. But there are significant challenges from religious freedom, and we need to recognise that in any law that we are going to design. And this, as I've said, for a decade has been something I've been very interested in. Because marriage means more than just a legal and a cultural institution, but has important religious power, we need to design a law that properly accommodates the importance of the religious tradition as well. I also think we need to do it because we have to recognise it's an intergenerational challenge or an intergenerational issue. The attitudes of people under the age of about 45 are often very different from people over the age of about 45, and that we need to adapt society in a way that takes people through together. So when you have an institution like marriage, which has legal, civil, cultural and religious traditions, what I've proposed is that we need to separate them out in law and recognise there's a civil tradition and there's a religious tradition. But to ensure we achieve that important human rights principle of equality before the law, we need to treat them equally in law. And from there, you can design various proper accommodations for people based on their private religious faith if they don't want to be participants in a same-sex marriage under the civil and the religious tradition. And then from there, you can create the sorts of exemptions that are necessary in anti-discrimination law to ensure that nobody is forced to act against their conscience. Now, those different exemptions sit on a scale, because some people think that they should apply for people who are, you know, bakers and various other things, and other people rightly think that they should apply, in my opinion, to things like civil registrars and civil celebrants. I think you can design a law that properly accommodates these tensions, but it has to be based on people being acting consistent with their faith. It has to be based on them pre-registering their attitudes that are exemptions, and then having a responsibility, a corresponding responsibility that comes with them wanting to be have the freedom to exercise their conscience by some form of referral or some type of alternative arrangement, particularly when we're talking about agents of the state such as civil registrars, so that no person faces discrimination. And I think if we do that and we face the issue in a pragmatic way, recognising the rights of everybody, it isn't the sort of divisive issue we need in our society. In fact, it provides the foundation for a proper understanding about the importance of religious freedom and provides the groundwork for a pact of which is the first of many issues that we can use to fully explore the importance of religious freedom and preserve it in a form of law that takes our country forward together.
Thank you, and I have realised I can in fact time this simply by bursting into applause at the appropriate place. Our third speaker is the Most Reverend Dr. Peter Comensoli, who's the third bishop of the Diocese of Broken Bay, and he was appointed to that see in 2014. He's the chairman of the Catholic Education Commission of New South Wales. Prior to his present appointment, he was an auxiliary bishop for the Archdiocese of Sydney and served as apostolic administrator during the period of the gap between ordinaries. he holds among a variety of degrees a Master of Letters from the University of St Andrews and a Doctorate of Philosophy and Theological Ethics from the University of Edinburgh, and invite you to make him welcome.
Hello everyone, hello to my panellists as well. We've moved from the right to the left now of the chair, so we'll see how this all goes. folks, I want to just make three points, I think, tonight to you to add to this conversation that we're beginning. The first one is around language. The second is around a definition of marriage. Of course, we need to know what it is we're talking about. And the final point I want to make is an acknowledgement. So let's start with the language side of things. It strikes me that much of the current debate about marriage has taken place at cross purposes. Those who understand marriage, like myself, as a partnership of life and love between a man and a woman, have tended to make their case using rational arguments, arguments from moral reasoning. And these rational arguments are focused on what marriage is, and from there, subsequently, to consider the individual who may or may not participate in that definition. So first marriage, and then the individuals. Those, on the other hand, who have advocated for a redefinition of marriage to include same-sex couples have tended to make their case using volitional arguments, arguments of the will. And volitional arguments focus on the experience of the individuals involved, and we've heard some of that already, and only subsequently consider how those experiences are captured under the heading of marriage. So first the individuals, then marriage. But note how those two arguments are at cross purposes. One focuses on reasoning and analysis, the other one on willing and narrative. And at its extreme, this is something we've all seen, it's led to the debate around marriage, sinking at times into exchange of what is really quite violent language. On one side, accusations of bigotry, on the other, accusations of intimidation. But this difference in purpose shows up especially, I think, in the question of equality, and where much of the debate is couched in the language of equality. So as the argument goes, two consenting adults of any sex or gender who freely choose to enter into a permanent sexual partnership should be allowed to describe what they're experiencing in their relationship as a marriage. therefore, they assert, an equal status with opposite sex couples who already have that right to describe what they're doing as marriage. And so same-sex couples now seek that right to be legally recognised. Yet the question of equality in law, and this is getting on dangerous ground, sitting with a bunch of legislators and lawyers, but I think the question of equality in law does not seek to deal with such questions, the volitional ones. Rather, it seeks to ensure that no individual or group of individuals is treated less than any other. But as far as I'm aware, that is already the case in Australia. Every couple who has entered into a legally recognised sexual partnership, no matter what sex or gender, shares equally in the legal protections on offer. So legal equality for same-sex couples already exists. Why then all the heat over equality? The reason, I think, is that the equality argument is not actually a legal argument, but a volitional one. It's an argument about what is wanted personally, not about what needs to be protected as a common law good. And in the end, the issue of same-sex equality does not actually touch on the question of what marriage is as a legal matter. Instead, it's about what people want marriage to be as a personal matter and what flows from that. Which leads to the second thing I want to look at tonight, the question of definition of marriage. So what makes a marriage marriage? In all its great variety and manifestations through history and cultures, three elements, I think, have come to mark out marriage as a particular kind of relationship of love, different from other kinds of relationships of love, for example, friendship or sexual desire. So to state my case for a definition, marriage is the free, faithful, fruitful kind of relationship. The free, faithful, fruitful kind of relationship. So not all relationships are freely entered into. So a profoundly cognitively disabled child may be loved by her parents and may respond to that love, but this is not a relationship freely entered into by her. Similarly, not all relationships involve a mutually exclusive fidelity. Friendships, the principal example of this kind of love. There's nothing exclusive about friendship. The more friends, the merrier. And finally, not all relationships are as part of the relationship, and I stress that part of it. So not all relationships as part of the relationship are open to the possibility of new life. While life making is technically possible without sex and with the aid of a third person, only the sexual union between a man and a woman is of itself able to be fruitful. So of all the many and varied kinds of relationships that bless our lives, only marriage is the kind of loving relationship where freedom, fidelity, and fruitfulness together come together. Lose one element of those three, and it ceases to be a married kind of love and becomes another kind of love. There's still love happening, but it's not marriage. And in fact, in the Christian tradition, marriage is not even the greatest kind of love. That honour is given to friendship. No greater love than to lay down one's life for one's friends. So what makes marriage? It's the free, faithful, fruitful kind of love. With that in mind, let me finish with an acknowledgement. That the current debate about marriage is occurring should not be surprising or unexpected. It's a logical consequence of the gradual uncoupling of lovemaking from lifemaking, which began many decades ago. Fidelity and fruitfulness have become less tied to our experiences of married life in Australia. with freedom being the remaining criterion upon which we tend to make the judgment, marriage or not. As a result, any consenting sexual partnership makes the grade as marriage-like. We might call this the personal love argument. It's the one non-volitional argument in the current marriage debate. It asserts that marriage is something that is freely chosen, a personal sexual partnership between two people who love each other. This has certainly been the lived experience of many Australians, and not much is needed to extend the argument, therefore, to include same-sex couples. If they love one another, then why not include them under the umbrella of marriage, so understood in terms of this freedom choice? But given the slow loss of compelling and attractive marriages that last and that are generously open to life, it's not surprising that such an argument has gained attention. Many of our younger generations choose not to marry. I think not because they wish to avoid commitment, but because they wish to avoid all the pain and the devastation of things like divorce and separation and so on. With fewer and fewer examples of a vision of a free, faithful and fruitful marriage that is real and lived, the redefinition arguments gain strength. But in making this acknowledgement, may I point out its implications? The more that we uncouple lovemaking from lifemaking, the more the personal love argument dominates, then the greater will be the demand for further redefinition. Things will not stop with the demand for legalising same-sex marriage. So as we give consideration to the various cultural and legal significances of marriage, let's do so from a perspective of an understanding of what marriage is, what brings marriage to the point of being marriage, so that then we can look at who as individuals may come under that particular definition of a kind of love. Thanks.
Well, our final contributor, I suspect, is known to everyone here. He's Paul Kelly, editor-at-large of The Australian and previously editor-in-chief of the same paper, who has written on Australian politics, public policy and international affairs from the time of Gough Whitlam through to Malcolm Turnbull, the author of 8 books, including End of Certainty, Triumph and Demise and the March of Patriots. And if I could welcome him to speak to us tonight.
Thanks, Greg. I'd like to thank the Australian Catholic University for holding this forum. I acknowledge Greg Craven as the Vice-Chancellor, Julian Lesser as the organiser of the event, and I want to acknowledge this very distinguished panel that I'm flattered to join. I'm speaking tonight not as an advocate of one side or another on same-sex marriage, but as a political analyst, and I'll have points of agreement and disagreement with the other panel members. The same-sex marriage cause has won much support because of the brilliant way it's been conceptualised in the political debate under the banner of marriage equality. It's rare that a two-word slogan has so swayed public sentiment. There seems to be almost no argument against this particular slogan. And when you talk to people about this debate, they repeat the slogan. It's powerful because it frames the issue in terms of discrimination. And discrimination in our society seems to have become an even more detested notion as its incidence has diminished. Depicting same-sex marriage as an anti-discrimination instrument is not just a powerful device with public opinion, but it defines and simplifies the entire issue. In intellectual terms, I believe, it's far more valid to see this change as a redefinition of marriage. the most important social institution, and the termination of its centuries-long meaning as a union between a man and a woman. Put this way, the change is epic. It's not just an issue of discrimination. This sort of change will have far-reaching import for families, children, education, faiths, churches, and many of our institutions. But it is not framed this way, and that's deliberate. Presenting the issue in terms of anti-discrimination and marriage equality narrows enormously the scope and meaning of the change. And I submit to this audience that almost none of the wider consequences of same-sex marriage have been debated, and let's be frank, most of the proponents don't want such a debate. I understand that. It only complicates the achievement of their objective. I followed the language of this debate for a number of years. It's dominated by emotion, personal experience, the demand for rights, and the insistence that love be recognised in whatever form it takes. A really powerful concept. Facing a campaign based on love recognition, the churches have singularly failed to offer convincing counter-arguments. The shift in public sentiment on same-sex marriage seems to me to be related to the declining moral authority of the Christian churches. Now, I respect the views of same-sex couples who want to get married, and I'm not saying they shouldn't be able to get married. What I am saying is, not only has the debate on this issue been inadequate, but to a large extent, many of the real issues have not been debated at all. Consider if we were looking at approval for a new coal mine, an alteration to penalty rates, or even amending the GST. Our interest groups, our media, and many of our MPs would be demanding exhaustive, multiple inquiries, searching interviews and analysis almost beyond reason before any reform. Yet on same-sex marriage, we are repeatedly told it should have happened yesterday, and we are not to be bothered with any more questions, assessments, or discussion. It's a moral issue. It's about recognising love. Now, I understand the sheer difficulty the politicians face in trying to grapple with this sort of campaign, but that's not the point. The point is they've failed. The Parliament's failed, and the process of media-facilitated public conversation has not touched the deeper issue. The legislation of same-sex marriage will mean the laws of the state and the laws of the church, or most churches at any rate, will be in conflict over the meaning of marriage. And this leads to the fundamental question, how tenable will this situation be? We don't know, but my sense of politics and history tells me it won't be tenable for long. This is because marriage equality is essentially an ideology. It's compared by many of its advocates with the elimination of racial discrimination, a comparison I believe to be false. Yet, the advocates embrace this comparison, and it does lead to powerful conclusions. There can be no halfway house on racial discrimination. There can be no distinction on racial discrimination between the law of the state and the law of the church. There can only be one law. If I am right, the authentic champions of marriage equality, the authentic champions, will begin their campaign to have just one law on same-sex marriage the moment the current success is achieved. Now, as you know, the current proposed bills to legislate gay marriage contain a narrow exemption. A religious figure, a representative of faith, cannot be compelled to preside at a same-sex marriage. Religious freedom is preserved at this narrow level. It is obvious, however, that once we legislate same-sex marriage, there will be a new campaign based on litigation and anti-discrimination law to extend the provisions. And I remind you of the nature of ideology. Ideologies, particularly ideologies that are winning, ultimately do not tolerate or enshrine dissident institutions. So this raises for me one of the central political issues in this debate. Is the push for same-sex marriage based on tolerance or intolerance? I think the evidence is mixed. This brings me to two fundamental conclusions. First, the imperative of religious faith cannot be used and should not be used anymore to deny same-sex marriage. And second, the right of same-sex marriage should not be used to deny religious freedom. I endorse very much the principle enunciated by fellow panelist Tim Wilson some time ago, that same-sex marriage rights and religious freedom should be seen as, quote, equally important, unquote, in this debate. They're not, of course. But I think, frankly, this is the only way to proceed for a respectful community. Politicians who think they are protecting religious freedom by having the single one-line exemption for a priest or pastor, frankly, are treating us like fools. In many ways, this is the ultimate disrespect. The issue is, will religious freedom of conscience be maintained? I think that too many politicians don't get it. Whenever I raise this issue with pro-same-sex marriage politicians, they either get dismissive or agitated. The dismissive ones say there is a proposed religious exemption anyway, so there's nothing to worry about. The agitated ones realise there's a much bigger issue, but they want to keep it repressed. Finally, I used to believe the issue of same-sex marriage should be decided by Parliament. I don't anymore. I support a plebiscite post-election. It may or may not deliver a better or fuller public debate, but it cannot be anything worse than the intellectual torpor and false morality that has dominated the parliamentary corridors and the chamber on the few occasions the issue has been canvassed. Thank you.
Well, those have been four excellent and very, very different approaches to the topic, and I think that we have had thus far a highly respectful conversation, different perspectives put in different ways and taking account of each other. Now, we have a 10-minute session where we have some pre-lodged questions that I'm going to put to different panellists. Other panellists should feel free to come in. My understanding now is that you will all be writing down your own questions or have written them. And I'm looking purposefully at Julian Lisa, who's nodding his head. We're evacuating the building now. No. So, Julian, people will be moving through the audience to collect those, and then at the conclusion of this part of the session, we'll move into asking those questions. Perhaps if I could start with a question for Bishop Peter. I think one of the things that is a fairly constant theme in this debate is people who will say to Catholics or other Christians or people of other faiths, well, look, we understand entirely that you don't want to marry people in same-sex relationships. We understand that you are opposed to it. Well, that's fine. You don't have to do it, and we're not going to make you do it. But why are you opposed to people outside your faith doing it? What interest does a Catholic or a Presbyterian or a Muslim have in saying that a person who is of no faith should abide by that view?
I think I'd want to answer that in two parts. The first part comes back to thinking about the nature of marriage and recognising that there are different kinds of love. We enter into different kinds of loving relationships. So let's name those kinds of relationships. So there's relationships like friendship. That's a particular kind of choosing friendship. There's eros as a concept of a desiring or a wanting kind of loving relationship, often associated with sexual relations. There is the nurturing kind of love, the sacrificial kind of love that relates often enough to parenting and so on. So let's name at least different kinds of loving relationships that we enter into. In naming them, then recognising something of the elements that go to make up those particular kinds of love. That's why I was talking a little bit about the elements of freedom, of fidelity, and of fruitfulness as being the elements that make marriage as a particular kind of love. And then looking at seeing who might be able to be free, who might be able to be faithful, who might be able to be fruitful, and find from there getting a sense of who comes under some sense of marriage. In all of that, note that I haven't put forward an argument that comes from faith. It's not an argument that I'm necessarily putting from faith. Now, my faith certainly, and in many regards, Christina enunciated a lot of those dimensions that faith needs to bring to the argument. But I think there is an argument, a reasoned, rational argument to put forward to name marriage for what it is, as it distinguishes from other kinds of love. And from there, we might then consider the question that you're raising about, well, isn't this just something you religious people are interested in? Well, no, this is something for the entirety of our humanity to be interested in, and the kind of loves that we might participate in and how we participate in them, well or not.
I wonder, though, why do we need to distinguish between those different types of love when talking about marriage? Because I think many marriages would have all of those types that you've described as elements of the love that the two people share, and permit that might change throughout the timeline of the marriage as well. I also wonder about the emphasis on fruitfulness being in terms of fruitfulness of having children, because that is what you mean, I presume.
In part, yes, but yes.
Well, that's I think in large, that's what you mean. And I would, one, challenge the idea that there are perhaps other ways a married couple can be fruitful in their relationship. And two, note that many marriages aren't able to be fruitful, either because of the age of the people within them, the medical conditions they bring to them, or perhaps some other reason. I mean, not to be crass, I did a little bit of math when you were talking. My husband and I have been married 20 years, I'm going to estimate, based on some statistics, et cetera, perhaps 3,000 times. We've had sexual relationships. It's only resulted in 3 children. I mean, on a percentage basis, we're not very fruitful.
It's the quality that counts. perhaps an open question to the panel.
But I get to the point being, my only point being here, that the emphasis on fruitfulness is very narrowly defined in your definition of what is a fruitful what is fruitfulness in marriage.
It's more to move away from the experiential aspects of it. So it's not the case of, as I won't go into the numbers for yourself.
My husband.
I don't go there.
He might have a different view if you were here.
but it's trying to describe something of the kind of love it is. Now, you're quite right that marriage has all the elements of friendship, it has all the elements of sacrificial, has all the elements of eros. Yes, yes, yes. But it's marriage that has all of them. Friendship doesn't have the eros.
Yeah.
The sexual desire one doesn't necessarily have freedom, for instance. Yeah. So it's those elements together that I'm trying to give some sort of capture around the idea of marriage.
A question across the panel. I mean, one of the assumptions in the title of tonight, in a sense, has been that much of the debate around this hasn't been respectful and mutually respectful. We all know that homosexual people over long periods of time have endured any number of insults. And I think people of faith have realised in this debate that it's not very far from saying, I disagree with you, to saying you're a bigot, you're not entitled to hold that type of view. I wonder if I could ask generally, I mean, how confident are we that we actually can have a civilised debate in the current circumstances? We're having one tonight. Are we able to do that? Are we able to do that in the context of a plebiscite?
Do you want to go, Paul?
You go first. I'll think about it.
I'm starting to think I wish you had gone first. I think it's a very difficult debate to actually have a respectful discussion about. Because in the end, it goes right to the core of people's sense of identity and sense of security. Is my thing not working? In society, I mean, when it comes down to it, people's faith is rightly very close to them in the same way, and part of their lived experience in life, to the point where people are prepared to make significant sacrifices, including the ultimate sacrifice in the name of their faith. In the same way that people with lived experience of being homosexual may have lived through a period where, and I keep coming back to this because I think it's very important to understand the historical context, particularly from the gay and lesbian community. 40 years ago, we were not debating the legal standing of our relationships based on whether it be recognised in law, that you would be thrown in jail, potentially, for your relationship. And even for a lot of people who are younger, who perhaps didn't experience that, like myself, that in the end it has a very significant influence about the degree to which you think society treats you with the same degree of respect as everybody else. So I think you're putting in a very difficult situation to start with. But I agree wholeheartedly with Paul that the political system has largely failed a respectful discussion. And again, I return to some of those numbers I said before about the attitudinal and shift. It's not just that we saw a huge shift in attitude over a relatively short period of time. It happened without any of the mainstream political forces driving it. I actually think that's quite extraordinary when you think about it overall. The Labour Party eventually succumbed to public attitude. The Liberal Party, broadly speaking, is still torn between two significant public attitudes on this issue, to the point if any I think objective observer would say they almost threw out one of their founding principles not to deal with it recently. And I think so long as the political class holds firm views and is not prepared to engage with it in a respectful way to look at the multifaceted and very serious issues around the rights of everybody involved in this discussion, I think it's very difficult to do indeed, and I think it's a great tragedy, and it's why I'm heartened by Paul's commentary and everybody else's in this space about the importance of religious freedom as part of the discussion to take it forward so that we can actually come out of this debate as a nation united.
Paul, do you want to comment particularly on the plebiscite nature of it? We don't tend to have plebiscites in Australia. There is some nervousness out there of what type of debate that will put up.
I think a lot of people struggle with the issue, and a lot of people have had their own views and values tested. Many people have assessed and changed their position. I think the sheer degree to which public opinion has moved so quickly has imposed a lot of strain on the system. It certainly imposed a lot of strain on many Liberal Party politicians. As I said, I've changed my mind about the Parliament plebiscite issue. I used to think the Parliament should decide, but I've become extremely disillusioned with the poor quality of the public debate, the media debate, and the debate from the parliamentarians. And so from that perspective, I've decided, well, let's have a plebiscite. It can't be much worse than what we've got so far. However, a couple of points about the plebiscite. I think more of the community is learning to discuss this issue in a respectful way. But because it goes to such fundamental issues, there will be in the plebiscite campaign polarisation and extreme positions on both sides. And we are likely to see extreme language from both sides. And one of the questions here is the extent to which the media plays up the extreme language, the polarised nature of the debate, rather than the respectful debate in the centre from both sides. And this could be very important, because if we get accusations of bigotry from one side or another, and this is really played up, this could then start to shift the debate to some extent. What we haven't seen from the government, of course, is what are going to be the ground rules of the plebiscite, how the plebiscite's going to be conducted, what are the arguments for and against, how they're going to be presented and so on. This simply has not been sorted out. So there's a lot of hard thinking to be done about this.
I've got some questions here. If I can pose one that I think runs underneath a number of them and then moves from the general to the specific. I think Tim mentioned, and all speakers have acknowledged, that in a sense what you've got here is a complex accommodation of different things that could be described as rights. Those who are proposing same-sex marriage see there as being a right for people to marry regardless of gender. And then there's the issue of freedom of religion, which of course is an accepted right in our society. Now, clearly in this context there is a tension between those two rights, potentially. The simplest one is where the churches would be required to marry people, and perhaps it's obvious that that's not the case. But then there are what you might call the downstream rights. Are churches allowed to express their opposition to same-sex marriage? And of course, you mentioned, Tim, the Supreme Court of the United States, where suddenly the right to religious freedom became a right to the expression rather than the exercise. I mean, how do we see the potential upsides and downsides, the tension points? How do you accommodate those two potentially tensioned rights? And what are the dangers and the opportunities?
When Paul was speaking about the laws in the church and the laws of the state potentially being in conflict should we legalize same-sex marriage, I thought, well, in fact, I live in a church and participate in a church where I'm always in conflict with the law. You know, my church can discriminate on who gets what jobs on the basis of gender. My church says divorce isn't allowed. My church says I can't use birth control, and my church says I'm not allowed to have abortions. Even though these things are all legal and available in the society in which I live. And my point being that in many places and in many ways, we live through these tensions already. We live them through with the operation of religiously affiliated and based schools. We lived them through and we debated them in the New South Wales Parliament when we legalized same-sex adoption and how would we give exemptions not just to faith-based organizations and deal with the issues of referrals and those sorts of things, but we even debated how to deal with individuals who worked for, say, civil institutions that provided adoption services but might have a religious objection. Of course, this is a cause at the moment in America with this woman in Kentucky who's refused as a civil employee to issue same-sex marriage license based on apparently her religious beliefs. I remember that Prue Goward, who was then the minister, the shadow minister for community services, making the point that if a person with a religious affiliation worked for a civil institution, they had the freedom to not work at that job, to make a decision to do something else. That's perhaps a slightly extreme point. I would agree with Tim that there would be ways, because we have dealt with these sorts of conflicts in many, and that's my point, in many other circumstances where we've had to accommodate the difference between church laws, church rules, church beliefs, and state law, whether that be in favor of the church or favor of the state. We've had to deal with that in many complex circumstances. I don't think this is beyond the wisdom and the wit of our legislatures to devise laws that can accommodate some of the complex issues that Paul's raised.
Just quickly taking up Christina's point, she's undoubtedly correct saying that there are all sorts of instances where there are different there are differences between the laws of the state and the laws of the church, and they've got to be worked through. However, I think this is an issue at a different level, and clearly the array of forces supporting same-sex marriage can't be characterised in an easy way. There is an alliance of forces there. But in my presentation, what I was doing was I was raising the debate about what is the nature of the marriage equality movement. Now, some people in the marriage equality movement simply want the right to get married, and that's fine, and when that comes in, the issue's settled. However, I do think there's a significant element of this which is an ideological movement. And I guess I tend to understand it more as an ideological movement. And so the question I then raise is, well, if that's true, if that is its real nature, can you actually tolerate a situation in which there's a halfway house? Isn't that incompatible with the nature of marriage equality ideology? So the question I'm raising is simply, in this particular case of same-sex marriage, how tenable is it to think that in the long run we're going to be able to live with this conflict between the laws of the church and the law of the state? I do think that this is a potential very serious problem.
Can we take a highly practical example of this, which is directly a question that's come up from the floor? It's posed to Tim Wilson, but I think it can equally be posed to everyone. As some of you would probably know from press reports, Archbishop Porteous in Hobart recently distributed what I understand to be simply the document putting the bishop's position in relation to same-sex marriage and explaining why that was opposed to a Catholic position and running the traditional arguments and some of the arguments we've heard tonight. And a complainant has already made a complaint to the Anti-Discrimination Board in Tasmania. So the question is, how does this work? If same-sex marriage is a right acknowledged by Australian law, then what is the position of churches, not the simple one, not to marry people in the same sex, but to freely speak their minds, right or wrong, for schools to teach positions? How does that work?
Before I answer that, I just want to respond to something that Paul said. I will answer the question, don't worry. Which is, I don't agree that there is a marriage equality ideology. There isn't. But there is a secularist ideology out there, of which this is just one of many issues that is used as a vehicle to advance that objective. The same issues that come up around this discussion came up around people, religious exemptions under anti-discrimination law, and some people very fervently believe that if public money is going into a religious institution, that it should get no exemptions from anti-discrimination law. And there are plenty of other examples that come up from time to time as well. Do I think there's a challenge in an accommodation between religious liberty and the rights of same-sex couples to be able to be civil and married? I do, actually, because I think part of the challenge we've had in the past is that religious freedom has sat on a pedestal. It has enjoyed very broad, ranging and wide exemptions. And as a consequence, they're a big target rather than focusing on substantively what is necessary for somebody to remain and act consistent with their conscience. And there's a very big difference between moving an institutional protection and the protection for an individual to live out their life as they see as a purpose, which is equally as much a rights violation as denying a same-sex couple the capacity to access civil matters. But on to the question. Sorry, it is actually quite an important point, I think, to draw the distinction. And how do you... The example with Archbishop Porteous is a very good, concrete one. Because the issue at hand is the law. It is not actually the person making the complaint. They are only taking advantage of the law that exists in Tasmania. And my personal opinion, if you go and read that law, Article 17 of Tasmania's Anti-Discrimination Act, is it uses the definition of sexual harassment as far too broad and invites these types of issues. There's a reason why the complaint has only been made in Tasmania. There are a whole bunch of people who don't want to tolerate other people's attitudes within society. That is not a new thing. Arguably, that is the view that a lot of people have around how the church deals with this issue. The issue is the law. It actually isn't a reflection of the actual debate, and the law needs to be fixed so that these sorts of complaints can't be invited.
Yes. I'd like to pick up on this two things here. The language has happened a couple of times around exemption and distinguishing it from protections. So the concept that that some people might be exempt from particular laws frames the whole question then in terms of what you might be able to step away from, which is normal for a particular society or culture. Whereas protections say these are things that are fundamental to a particular culture or society. And so in terms of a language thing, the whole talk about exemptions is itself deeply flawed, I think. Yet it is the language which is being used all the time. Let's give the religious pastors an exemption. Rather than recognising that in a freedom of conscience, this is a stepping up of a protection of one's conscience within a society. So as a general thing. More specifically, I think one of the challenges, and if I can pick up here something that the point you're making, Christina, about how legislators in Australia should be able to get these things right if we debate them well enough. Well, they're not getting them right in Great Britain, they're not getting it right in Canada, they're not getting it right in the United States. So why should we expect ourselves to get it right when so often what happens is these, I can't remember your exact phrase, Greg, but the rights that are further down the stream a little, that are more fundamental, are being undermined because there is a loss of a freedom of expression around one's religious position those countries.
Isn't that a general challenge in this debate, that if you look at the jurisprudence in, say, Canada or Europe or indeed the United States and the recent decision of the Supreme Court, there's at least an argument that while all freedoms are equal, some are more or less equal than others, and that religious freedoms tend to lose out to other types of freedoms. And if that's the case, how confident would people of faith be that this debate would go in the way that one might expect?
I don't know that I necessarily agree, Bishop Commonsoli, that other jurisdictions are getting it wrong. I would accept that other jurisdictions are grappling with what Paul rightly calls an epic change, and what I have described as perhaps the most rapid, and you alluded to this as well, the most rapid evolution of public opinion on a social change. So many times when I listened to various speakers, I was reminded of previous waves of social change, whether it's women getting the right to vote, for goodness sake, whether it's people of color around the world gaining civil rights in places like the United States or in Australia. And I would say in those circumstances as well, it was complicated, it was messy, there were things we didn't get right straight away. There were things that we had to understand the consequences of actions. And this is where I do agree with Paul. I guess my point about the wit of our legislatures to frame a law is that we have dealt with this previously. We have dealt with the issue of living with the tension of religious communities and their ability to express and live their beliefs, and living in tension with civil law and civil society. That was my point, that we have dealt with it previously and we can do so again. I do, however, agree with Paul that the quality of the debate at a political and parliamentary level has been appalling, and have thought for some time that a plebiscite is the only way we're going to have a full discussion where the issues like that you have raised, Bishop Commonsoli, can be fleshed out and understood. Because Paul is exactly right when he says our federal parliamentarians haven't really intellectually engaged with those questions. They look at a poll that says 70% supports this, and if you're a politician, no matter what they say on Sky News or anywhere else, they look at polls. So I suspect that that a plebiscite is the only way we're going to flush some of these issues out and be able to ventilate some of those challenges. But I don't think it's beyond the capacity of us as a civil society to do so.
There are a series of questions here, and I'll try and combine them all together. But they concern the question of children. So the issue is obviously where they're in marriage, there often are children. Bishop Peter would probably say that definitionally there's an openness to children. Children have an interest in marriage, as well as partners, husbands, wives, whatever we call them. What is the position of children in this? What are the legitimate expectations of children? What are the rights of children, and how are they to be recognised?
Can I know, just finished speaking, but there's something that I would like to say about the ideal versus the what's possible. And this relates to back to some of my concerns and frustrations with the Catholic Church on this. We seem to have an obsession in the Catholic Church with almost the Thomistic ideal of what it is to be human and what it is to be what is perfect, really. And I think sometimes we let the perfect become the enemy of the good. And so when the Catholic Church and others talk about an ideal circumstance for children as having a mother and father, and if we want to broaden this out to debates about IVF and all sorts of other things, you know, a mother and a father that they know, sure, that is the ideal. Fine, if you want to describe that as the ideal, but I can tell you as a legislature and someone who's had portfolio responsibility for vulnerable people, the ideal is so far from being able to be recognized in so many people's lives. And one of the most compelling arguments for passing same-sex adoption in New South Wales, which was done on a conscience vote, was because we should not let the perfect become the enemy of the good. We should not allow some children who don't have the ability to access a mother and a father, or people who love them unconditionally and they give self-sacrificing love to them, we shouldn't say because they don't have the ideal, they can't have something that is good. Now, others might take, other people, particularly people who argue for rights for same-sex people, might disagree with my distinction between the ideal and the good, but I'm speaking from the perspective of the argument I most often hear from the Catholic Church. I fear that sometimes we too often let the ideal become the enemy of what is the good.
I've not been one who've used the ideal and the good sort of distinction. I readily recognise that the lived realities of families has always been mixed, always has been. And children have been raised in all sorts of circumstances and raised well and raised with a great sense of love and goodness and all the sorts of things you want, safety and all those sort of things in terms of children. So that has never been a part of my way of seeing this question. The distinction I want to make, though, is often enough the argument around the having of children as it's being currently had is putting the rights on the parents, rather than remembering where the child is in all of this. And that's what worries me about all of this at the moment, that they're in moving towards, and we're opening up a whole series of other questions that are way beyond anything to do with same-sex marriage. But nonetheless, where does the child sit in all of this? And what's good for the child really matters to me.
Probably got time for two more questions that sort of come from the floor and seem to have some currency. One contains an assumption, I suspect, about the outcome of the debate, and I'd again pose it generally. It says, given the inability of church groups to mount a convincing argument against the change, so there's an assumption that there is an inability to make that, what prospect is there of, if you like, a no case to a plebiscite effectively countering the push for same-sex marriage? Paul, you're the pundit here.
Well, as I said, we know nothing about the plebiscite. What's the question? That is just fundamental.
And who
what on earth? What on earth is the question going to be? Look, when all these polls are conducted about same-sex marriage, again, the question is very important. And depending upon the question that's put, you get quite a significantly different answer. So, you know, you might, for example, put a question, you know, do you believe there should be same-sex marriage, or people should have the right to same-sex marriage? You'll get one result. And if you say, do you think marriage should remain a union between a man and a woman, you'll get another result. Now, I'm not wishing to deny that there has not been a significant shift in public opinion. Of course there has. So I think we would start off thinking it would be difficult for the no case to win the plebiscite. However, what I would say is this. This is a pretty open and unpredictable situation at the moment. We know nothing about the ground rules. We know nothing, as Christina says, about who is going to run this operation, who's going to frame the question. You can be certain there's just going to be an enormous brawl on every aspect of this all the way through. It's going to be uncertain. It's going to be unpredictable. What role will the politicians play? What role might Malcolm Turnbull as Prime Minister play in the campaign? Will he attempt to campaign to represent his own personal view? Will he be alert to the fact that opinion among coalition voters is reasonably divided on this issue? Will he be therefore more circumspect? Will he stay out of the debate? I mean, this is highly unpredictable. And then what are the arguments for both sides? What will be the argument against same-sex marriage? I think one of the great problems so far is that there has not been a persuasive secular argument. Having said that, I think there hasn't been a persuasive religious argument either. But I do think that the case for same-sex marriage, I think there are potential problems with that case when it's mounted in a plebiscite campaign and put under scrutiny. And one of the issues here, which both Tim and I alluded to, of course, is what are the terms and conditions under which we're going to have same-sex marriage? What are they going to be?
I have no more expertise in plebiscites than anyone, but having been deputy to Malcolm Turnbull in the Republican referendum, I know all about losing referenda. It'd be interesting to ask the panel, what should the plebiscite look like? Is it a simple question, are you in favour of same-sex marriage? And if it's that, is there an enhanced danger of a super right that comes in? Should it be, are you in favour of same-sex marriage with the following other rights as well being accommodated? Should it be a piece of legislation?
On that point, I don't think the question should be, are you for or against same-sex marriage? This just means we're stuck in the hole we've been stuck in over the last few years. It's got to deal with the issue of rights, and it's got to have some qualifications in the question, particularly, I think, in relation to religious freedom. So that's the first thing I'd say about the question. I'd say we cannot have that sort of simple question.
Tim?
Well, I want to put it on record in the discussion that I'm very opposed to a plebiscite. And I understand other people have different views on this, but when it comes down to it, I struggle with a plebiscite, and I'll confess a large part of it on a personal level, because I can't imagine how people like me would feel in a country the day after if we voted no. In fact, I don't think many people would understand just how damaging that will in the same way that would be in the same way if we put an Indigenous recognition referendum up and we voted no. But in that context, I'm going to say I think the way forward is to do what I've always recommended, which is we should have some piece of legislation which has proper, concrete, considered protection and accommodation for religious freedom. And we should essentially have, if we're going to have a plebiscite that says, should this bill pass in law? But to get that sort of outcome, and to get the sort of outcome I think anybody who cares about religious freedom would want, assuming there's a change in the law, is not in the hands of advocates for marriage for same-sex couples. It comes down to how religious groups engage in this discussion. Because while we bemoan the state of the debate to date, and I think there's plenty of good reasons to, a large part of that is because of the way religious communities have engaged, which has been, this violates our religious freedom or our values, therefore it's not going to happen. Rather than having the discussion about how we accommodate change in a successful way, and whether people like me who advocate for change and want generous religious freedom and protections win, or those who are more secularist in their attitude win, is largely dependent on how religious communities engage and who they and the approach they take to whose case they bolster.
I'm conscious of the time. There's one last question I'd like to pose that's come from the floor. It's based on the opposite assumption. It's based on the assumption that we don't get same-sex marriage coming forward successfully, whether it fails at a plebiscite or otherwise. And, you know, as Paul said, these things are always unpredictable depending on the variables. If that is the case, what is the position of a loving same-sex couple in a monogamous relationship, deeply committed to a church, whatever that church may be? What is the position that they hold? Bishop Peter?
You're looking at me, aren't you?
I was consciously looking away from you, but yes.
The first and last point on anything is the dual commandment to love. That we love God, that we love one another. So that's the first and last, and in fact everything in between. Mm. Now that my understanding of love then needs to be nuanced in terms of, you know, I've talked a little bit already about there's been various kinds of love, and where then does the best way that someone, each individual, lives out their lives in regards to that. That's where the question of so that one is living according to their conscience and has made it properly informed and all of those aspects that need to be done in regards to that. That's where the Pope Francis line of who am I to judge comes in. The judgment is always going to be a judgment of love, but the judgment needs to be one that is formed, very well formed in one's conscience.
I want to reflect that we're right now in the Catholic Church holding the Synod on the Family.
Certainly are.
And when I say we, I don't really mean we. I mean the bishops are doing it with a few invited observers. But that's in a little aside. Last year in the first Synod, the pre-Synod to the Synod, there was a draft document that was released for about 5 days. And that draft document talked about acknowledging that there are families in the community who live with same-sex parents and welcoming them into our churches and, you know, respecting them. And there were other things in the document about divorced and remarried Catholics. Now, that first draft eventually it took 5 days, and it was rejected, disappeared, put to the side, whatever term you'd like to use. But the point is that there were people at the very senior leadership of the Catholic Church who had at least felt emboldened or compelled by their consciences to articulate those things within the context of a synod being held on the family. And this is back to my point about the church evolving, the church understanding, the church struggling itself on earth to understand how do we accept that we acknowledge homosexual orientation as a valid, genuine way that people are born. How do we then acknowledge and support those people to live genuine lives, self-expression, and in relationship, genuine relationship to one another, to live sacramental lives, if you will. So for me, I don't know where it leads your hypothetical a homosexual couple who wants to live a faith-filled life. It probably leaves them somewhere where they are right now, but also with which is a combination of frustration and hope. And I think that's the life most same-sex people in Australia, whether they're religious or not, are leading right now. A life that is one of both frustration and hope. And the only question I have when we debate what are we going to do as a country about same-sex marriage is how long they're going to live in that tension between frustration and hope, and whether the next phase in a plebiscite will be a step forward or indeed for them just another level of frustration.
Could I just add a little bit there, Christina, in the as I'm reading things at the Synod at the moment, one of the themes that is emerging is the need to find new language. And as one of my brother bishops put it, words create worlds. And in coming up with different words, the sense of hope arises.
Well, I'm not sure that we've managed to resolve the debate for the satisfaction of the entire Commonwealth, nor indeed that we've attempted to, but I think it has proved, as Tim says, that you can in fact have a respectful debate on this, that you can have different views being exchanged, and that that can be done in a civilised and, may I use the word that I use to explain the Church at its best in these discussions, urbane sort of way. And I think what we all have to hope, whatever outcome we want, is that that debate can be carried on into a wider audience and not degenerate into the sort of difficult debate that I think we all, you know, at one level or another worry that it might come if it went the wrong way. So look, can I on your behalf thank our panel? Can I thank all the organisers who went to a great deal of trouble to make sure this event could happen? And in fact, we're having a similar event in Melbourne with a different panel coming up, I think, next week. No, this week. So
Thursday.
Two in 1 week. And I understand we also have small gifts for the panel, but I'll perhaps get Julian to present them afterwards to save embarrassment. So thank you all very much for coming, and I wish you a very good night.